My understanding of the historical Jesus, in briefest summary, the three terms: Mediterranean, Jewish, peasant.
He's endlessly attractive and endlessly puzzling.
To restrict the Jesus of history to what can be reconstructed historically, that doesn't tell you anything that explains the significance of the person of Jesus of Nazareth.
The reason Jesus continues to be dynamically relevant is because he rose from the dead.
Over the past decade, there's been a resurgence of scholarship around Jesus. Many experts see this as another quest for the historical Jesus. In other words, a search for the facts around the major figure of Christianity. This new quest has brought praise, controversy, and condemnation. This is the campus of Oregon State University, where a major symposium called Jesus at 2000 is being held. Scholars believe Jesus was born about 4 BC, which means 1996 is the 2000th anniversary of Jesus' birth. I'm Bill Turpie. Join me for an exploration around the debate and inquiry concerning the age-old question, who is Jesus? Can a new quest for the historical Jesus answer the age-old question, who is Jesus? This renewed quest is being conducted in university classes, scholarly seminars, TV forums, and even by email. Two of the best-known pursuers of the quest are Dominick Crossen and Marcus Borg. They are among today's hottest religious authors and are members of the controversial Jesus Seminar. The seminar's claims find a Jesus much different from what Christians have historically believed.
He's had three books on the top 10 bestseller list in religion in the last...
Marcus Borg introduces Dominick Crossen to his religion class at Oregon State University. Though Crossen's and Borg's ideas are anything but traditional, those ideas have brought them notoriety and a stream of speaking engagements. They are among the stars of the new quest for the historical Jesus. What disturbs many traditional and Orthodox Christians is that Borg and Crossen tend to see much of the Christian story in the same vein as they see ancient myths.
Luke tells the story of the birth of Jesus. The Holy Spirit overshadows Mary. And the son who is born of Mary and the Holy Spirit, Mary and God, plain language, is the Son of God, right? Now let me tell you another story from the same time. Augustus, the emperor, when Jesus was born, there is a story in the historian Suetonius who says that on the night Augustus was conceived, the emperor, he wasn't the emperor then, of course, his mother Atzia was in the temple of Apollo and she fell asleep during the service and remained on in the temple afterwards. And during the night, Apollo, in the guise of a snake, impregnated her. He didn't even have the grace to ask her permission, which at least the Jewish God did. Impregnated her, so the child who was conceived that night was from a human mother and a divine father.
Crossen contends that this mythical story has to be set right next to the account of Jesus' birth in the Gospels.
But now you've got two stories. One says Augustus is the Son of God, is divine. The other says Jesus is the Son of God, is divine. Now, how do you do it? Do you say, well, I don't take the Augustus stuff literally, but I take the Jesus stuff literally, or I take neither of them literally, or I take both of them literally, or how do you handle two stories like that?
With this question, Dominick Crossen, a former Roman Catholic priest, introduces both the debate and the tension engaging scholars and everyday Christians in this new quest to understand Jesus. As part of the Jesus Seminar, Crossen and Borg meet twice a year with a group of about 50 other scholars to examine the historicity of all the words and deeds of Jesus. The seminar has published the five Gospels, which details the sayings and acts of Jesus its participants have voted to be historical. Their conclusion is that only about 18% of Jesus' sayings in the Gospels are authentic. Critics say the seminar is just a ploy to gain media attention.
The Jesus Seminar has as one of its purposes the raising of consciousness about another way of looking at Scripture. I don't think, though, that it's simply an attempt to put down an earlier way of seeing things for the sake of negating it. I really think it's a way of saying the Bible is more than the literalists think it is.
Marcus Borg's book, Meeting Jesus Again for the First Time, climbed quickly onto the religious bestseller list. Borg likes to make a distinction between the pre-Easter Jesus and the post-Easter Jesus. He says the first one is closer to what the real Jesus is about. The post-Easter one has been embellished by his early followers as they added their own faith-biased views to the record.
There are two groups of Christians, one for whom the truth of Christianity rests upon an infallible scripture, which they understand to mean that it's literally and historically correct whenever it seems to be speaking about such matters. And for them, my work, the work of the Jesus Seminar and so forth, is simply threatening and destructive. But there's another group of Christians, also numbering in the millions, for whom a literalistic approach to scripture ceased to work sometime, typically in their teens or their 20s. And for them, a way of understanding scripture and Jesus and Christian origins that doesn't depend upon believing things they can't make themselves believe offers a way back into the church.
The Gospels of the New Testament, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, represented here by their historic symbols. Matthew, angel with a human face. Mark, a winged lion. Luke, a winged ox. John, the eagle. Each representing a different aspect of Jesus. These Gospels have become the new battleground in this new quest. The Jesus Seminar contends that they are unreliable records and proposes that Jesus' birth and his resurrection are not historical, but inventions and poetic descriptions of the early church to describe its feelings for Jesus. Assertions like these have brought sharp criticism from both the conservative and moderate wings of Christianity. In fact, the tenor of the critique has led some in the media to call the disagreements the Jesus Wars.
This is not so much the Jesus Wars as perhaps, what shall we call, some street fighting in the ruined village of historic Christianity.
Luke Timothy Johnson, a former Benedictine priest and New Testament professor, is the author of a sharp critique of the Jesus Seminar called The Real Jesus, The Misguided Quest for the Historical Jesus and the Truth of the Traditional Gospels. He charges the seminar with practicing fraudulent scholarship.
They basically dismember the Gospels into pieces and then look at the pieces. To me, this is totally counterintuitive for any historiography and for any proper biography. The character of a person is found in the pattern of their life, the story of their life, not in individual events or incidents. My problem with them is that they say history is equated with reality, or historical knowing is the only way of knowing. What I insist is that a great deal of human experience is not accessible to history.
But the Reverend Tom Wright, New Testament scholar, formerly at Oxford, now Dean of Historic Lichfield Cathedral in England, and a prolific author, says history is exactly what the gospel accounts are filled with. He faults the seminar for failing to do good historical work.
That because God has committed himself to history in Jesus of Nazareth, we have to be historians, we have to ask the questions, we have to say what precisely was going on. And in my experience, many Christians have shied away from that and prefer a Jesus image of a Jesus who's sort of floating through life 6 inches above reality, never quite having his feet on terra firma.
Well, that is the question. Can the Gospels be taken as historical documents, or are they just simply faith statements?
Right. Well, they are faith statements, but that doesn't mean they're not historical documents. I mean, that's the critical thing to say, that the Gospels are determined to say these things actually happened.
Good morning, and welcome to Trinity Institute's 27th National Conference, Jesus at 2000.
The present fascination with Jesus may be attributed to the belief that there is something that has long been hidden from the average person, that scholars have now uncovered new sources or new evidence that Jesus may not be who he has long been portrayed by the church. This fascination is bringing together the academic world and the world of the church.
The wisdom tradition of the Hebrew Bible.
This national symposium called Jesus at 2000 was organized by Oregon State University and the Trinity Institute to commemorate the 2000th anniversary of Jesus' birth. Using the latest in satellite technology, the symposium linked six scholars with academic and religious sites around the country to wrestle with the question, who is Jesus?
The question from Buffalo is, referring to pre-Easter and post-Easter, what happens to his development if he puts both human and divine in pre-Easter column?
Again, a very good question, comment. I think historically speaking, you're right that in the history of the church, there has been a much greater emphasis on the post-Easter Jesus than on the pre-Easter Jesus.
Well, it was my hunch that a collaboration between Trinity Institute and Oregon State University would bring together the communities of the academy and the church on a very important hot topic, Jesus and who he is. And that's paid off beautifully because we have over 310 downlinks all across the country in virtually every state. And we also, we had 1,100 people signed up to come and sit here. And
part of what draws people to an event like this is the opportunity to meet and listen to stars of the Jesus Wars, like Marcus Borg, who knows how to make the rudimentary entertaining.
The most widely accepted date for the birth of Jesus is no later than 4 BC. And people are sometimes surprised that Jesus is born 4 years before Christ, but the explanation is that our current calendar, dividing history into BC and AD, was calculated by a 6th century Christian monk named Dionysius Exiguus, whose name in English is Denny the Dwarf. And he was off by 4 years in his calculations, which is not bad for somebody working in the 6th century with minimal documentation and so forth.
Many in attendance find Borg's approach inviting.
I've read Borg's book, Meeting Jesus Again, for the first time, and it was probably one of the most refreshing perspectives on new paradigms, new ways of looking at faith and spirituality, and coming to grips with a lot of the tenets of Christianity that I've had real hard time resolving.
Sentiments like this are driving book sales. There is an intense quest for publications about Jesus and this new quest. Both Marcus Borg's book and Dominick Crossen's book, The Historical Jesus, have sold over 100,000 copies. When we come back, a look at the debate over the birth of Jesus. Was it miraculous or just controversial? In asking the question, who is Jesus, the method and circumstances of his birth have to be brought under scrutiny. 2,000 years after his appearance, scholars are still wrangling over the method and meaning of his birth. The historic creeds of the church say that Jesus was born of a virgin, a tough concept for a scientific age to swallow. Many scholars reject the idea outright, but not all. And there is more than just the mode of birth to consider.
I would presume that Jesus was born in the perfectly normal way of two parents, Mary and Joseph, that he was born in Nazareth, a small hill village in Lower Galilee, sometime around, say, 4 BCE, years just before the turn of the Common Era century.
Virgin birth story, I think, is clearly not to be taken literally, but is the result of a community's thinking in more Hellenistic terms, that any person of sufficient importance to society must be born like the heroes were born of the relationship between a god and a human mother.
They lived in a world where all sorts of strange stories about Greek gods and heroes circulated, and the fact that Matthew and Luke, who are very Jewish writers in their own way, were prepared to say something like this about Jesus makes me think they wouldn't have done that unless they really believed there was something extremely odd and remarkable that had happened.
What I would draw the line at in terms of my understanding and theology is any claim that something supernatural did not happen at his birth. If someone were to say, well, science shows that's impossible, I would not believe that person, because if God could make the laws of nature, God can also break them or suspend them.
Ignatius was a martyr, an early bishop who died somewhere around the beginning of the second century. Ignatius reports that the birth of Jesus took place in the silence of a cry. Now, this isn't an historical account. It's simply a reaction of the cosmos to the birth of a significant individual.
What you have here is a displaced family, a refugee family, a poor family, with a woman who is pregnant under questionable circumstances, say the least. For me, that is the most important part of the birth story of Jesus.
How do we get from a monotheistic Jew to the second person of the Trinity?
Symposiums like the one at Oregon State don't spend a lot of time on questions of the virgin birth. Their intent is to struggle more with what Jesus said and did than how he got here. Many of those attending and following the quest for the historical Jesus believe that exploring a less traditional view of Christianity has actually saved their relationship with the Christian faith.
I grew up in a mainline church, but there was a strong fundamentalist emphasis through high school, and that really repelled me. And then in college, an approach like this really enabled me to kind of come back into the church, and it really nourishes my faith now. So I think it's opened the door for me to come back.
Many people would say that this is almost a denial of the Christian faith, and others would see something else. How do you see it?
I see this as an enrichment of our Christian faith, not as a denial of anything, but looking at the symbols that we have and bringing new meaning to them.
Well, a number of students and lay people say this reinterpretation of Christianity has actually helped them to remain in the Christian faith. There are a number of others who say that the assertions and conclusions drawn by the Jesus Seminar and of some of the conclusions here from the Jesus at 2000 Symposium are for them severe violations of their understanding of Christianity. Steve and Karen Luton work with InterVarsity Christian Fellowship at Oregon State. They are missionaries to the university community trying to help students accept Jesus into their lives. A Jesus who is much closer to the views of traditional Christianity than to the reinterpretations found in this recent quest for the Jesus of history.
Students are looking for something that is true. Mm-hmm. And the way that it's being presented by the Jesus Seminar is a more watered down picture of that. And I don't think to a lot of students who are looking for something that to give their lives to, something that is going to give them a purpose, that's not the Jesus they're presenting.
The Jesus Seminar allows you, that picture of Jesus allows you to tap into a spiritual world. You don't deny that there's no spiritual, you don't deny that there's mm-hmm. meaning and a place to find hope. It just removes it a step away from you so that you can pick and choose. Mm-hmm. I can look at the Bible and the things that Jesus says that I agree with, I can hold and say, I think Jesus is wonderful. And the other things that Jesus says that I don't understand, I don't mm-hmm. like, I can cut out and say he didn't say them or say they're just not relevant for me.
Critics of the Jesus Seminar and its proponents, like Crossen and Borg, say that what the seminar has done is find in the Gospels the type of Jesus this particular group of scholars would like to be there. One who would accept the present scientific model of the universe and sign up for all the liberal causes of the moment.
I worry about the twist they put on the picture of Jesus. I think it's far too politically correct. What is eliminated is the hard message of the cross, that Jesus gave his life in service to others, is the call to repentance, is the identification of sin as a disease deep in the heart of human freedom and not simply as social structures.
But scholars involved in the quest say they must pursue what they believe is historical. They argue they have to search for material which is clearly factual, material which has not been altered by the followers of Jesus.
Now, I don't think there's any doubt in anybody's mind that there was a figure called Jesus who actually lived in history. I think nobody, none of the scholars here doubt that. What they're saying is, if you set aside all of the faith affirmations we make about Jesus and simply reduce what we know to what would pass a neutral or skeptical historical analysis, then what do we have? That's a very different question, very different question.
That Jesus was crucified in Jerusalem, and was crucified in some cooperation between the highest temple authorities and the Roman occupation authorities, in some conjunction with Passover. And whether it was on Passover Day or Passover Eve is not clear, but in some conjunction with Passover. That I would take absolutely as fact. And then that even though this person was killed and the movement should have stopped there, as Tacitus and Josephus admit, the movement not only continued, but the movement spread.
The aspects of Jesus which are most likely to be historical, I think, begin with the crucifixion. The crucifixion is sufficiently scandalous, a mode of death, that it would be, I think, unlikely that anyone would make up a story like that. And then you work backwards from there. If the crucifixion is likely to be historical, perhaps the empty tomb is equally likely to be historical. The fact that no one saw him rise is equally likely to be historical. The inscription on the cross is a very, very important piece of evidence. Jesus of Nazareth, King of the Jews, is not the kind of thing that the church wished to proclaim about Jesus. They really thought that he was something much greater and more important than that. So therefore, the messianic notion that he was crucified as a messianic pretender, let's say, as a candidate for the title of Messiah, I think is likely to be very historical.
Christianity has always, from the beginning, made certain claims about things that actually happened in the real world of history. Christianity was never simply a religion that said, here's a new experience which you might like to try on for size. Christianity was always a religion which said, something has happened in the real world of history, and you've got to get on board with it. And so, as a historian, I am enormously excited to use those skills in finding out what precisely happened and what it meant to the first people who experienced it.
In trying to sort through the material of the Gospels, scholars on both sides of this battle have to come to some conclusions about how Jesus related to Judaism, the religion of his day, and how he understood God and his own mission or message. As they wrestle with these questions, a fuller picture begins to emerge. A picture which may help solve the mystery of who is Jesus and what is his relationship with God.
If we're talking about a movement within Judaism, and let's call it the companionship of the kingdom, as it were. I think it's a peasant movement. I think Jesus is a peasant talking to peasants. That starts the movement. When he invokes the kingdom of God, he says, this is not the way God wants the world run. Now, hear what I'm saying. There is no separation in this world between politics and religion. Church and state being separated, nobody in the first century, pagan, Jewish, anyone would have understood what on earth you were talking about. How could you separate religion and politics? How could you separate the gods of Rome from the empire of Rome? When Jesus then talks about the kingdom of God, what he's talking about is how this world should be run if God was sitting on Caesar's throne. And you can imagine that that is both 100% political and 100% religious. This ain't the way God wants the world run. That's the message.
The primary quality of God in the teaching of Jesus is that God is compassionate. And that's a very rich word because of its associations in Hebrew and Aramaic. It's connected to the word for womb. So Jesus is saying, in effect, you want to know what God is like? God is like a womb. God is womb-like, which is a very provocative metaphor, and it has associations of life-giving, source of life, nourishing, perhaps even embracing or encompassing. Now, Jesus' understanding of God is also one that can lead Jesus to have great passion in indicting social injustice and so forth. So it's not just a nice, sweet image of God, but God has compassion for all people, and therefore, according to Jesus, God is angered at the injustice that people inflict on each other.
The person of Jesus is exemplified in what he does, his actions, just as much as what he says. So that to take the aphorisms of Jesus apart from the actions in which he cures a deaf man, or heals somebody who's paralyzed, or straightens a woman who's been bent over from birth, all those actions are something that characterize the person of Jesus. They may not be something that presents him as Plato, but they are certainly something in which the character of who he is, his compassion for other human beings, comes through. So I would say you have to look at who he is by what he says and by what he does.
He lived and died as a Jew under Jewish law. I think he had some radical interpretations of what that law ought to be, but everyone living in that society must have been living under Jewish law. It was both the political truth and the religious truth. It was his church, if you will, but also his constitution. And so it would have been impossible for him not to have believed deeply in the law, and nothing he says suggests to me that he didn't.
When Jesus at 2000 returns, a look at whether there is a difference between historical fact and religious faith. One of the most outspoken critics of this new quest for the historical Jesus is Dr. Luke Timothy Johnson, professor of New Testament here at Emory University's Candler School of Theology. He asserts that this new quest has confused ordinary Christians and has created a large gap between people in the pews and scholars in the seminaries. And he also asserts that this new quest is not historical and doesn't give us the real Jesus any more than scholars can give us the real Socrates.
Luke Johnson notes that the church has interpreted Jesus through his disciples, just as Socrates is understood through his disciple Plato.
And what Plato learned from Socrates and what Plato did to Socrates are no longer clearly distinguishable. The quest for the historical Jesus is completely irrelevant if we want to ask the question, how do we get at the real Jesus? The real Jesus is a living presence. That acknowledgement, that commitment of the mind and heart is fundamental to what it means to be Christian. Now, if one does not want to make that commitment, that is, that the real Jesus is the living, powerful Lord present in the hearts of believers, present in the Holy Spirit in the world, then, of course, when one says one is doing the historical Jesus, one is going to take an entirely different approach. If we ask the historian to talk about Rembrandt, the historian would have to reduce Rembrandt to some kind of art history, which does not by itself give us a sense of what Rembrandt's art is doing. We need an artist to understand Rembrandt's art. In the same way, religious experience has to be approached through religious knowing.
And religious knowing for Johnson involves partly a commitment to the idea that religious or spiritual truth is as valid as historical truth. It just can't be subjected to the same tests.
So he's writing, "Dear Luke, with Dom listening in, let me begin by acknowledging it's difficult to know how to respond. On the one hand, I find myself agreeing with much that you say. On the other hand, we are perceived as opponents in a scholarly brawl marked by heated rhetoric."
Johnson, Crossen, and Borg have been carrying out their debate by email. In the past, varying views on doctrinal issues took decades to circulate. But in today's information-rich culture, this debate is unfolding in real time on the Internet.
According to your book and articles, Crossen and I are among those seeking to destroy Christianity as well as be naive and incompetent historians. I think that's a pretty fair characterization of what I suggested.
I think you have put them in that light.
My argument is that the real Jesus is the Jesus in the pages of the gospel. And this Jesus has been accessible to all who read. There are no strange, esoteric, eccentric, secrets about Jesus that only further research can uncover. All of the recent archaeological discoveries, all the new methods in historiography fundamentally lead us back to what is an alternative version of the same story. And if that's the case, then I would prefer the version in the Gospels themselves.
One reason behind this sentiment is Johnson's intense belief that you can't reduce Jesus to a bunch of scattered sayings. He is more than just a string of his best comments. The gospel writers didn't set out to write an autobiography of Jesus. They wanted to write a document that led to some conclusions. Dominick Crossen says he can follow the conclusions, but he doesn't always agree with the history many times behind those conclusions.
John tells the story of Jesus' trial in a way in which Jesus is really trying Pilate. That's what's going on. Truth and power meet. Truth wins. Power thinks it wins. That's the scenario, the way John... Pilate's not in charge at all. He's running backwards and forwards like a little messenger boy. Do I think it happened like that? Not for a moment. Do I think John's account is wrong? Not for a moment. John's right. Yeah, Pilate lost that day. He didn't know it for 100 years, or 200 years, whenever you want to date, when the Romans knew it was too late. The Roman Empire was finished that day. Pagan Roman Empire lost. Yeah, John makes that as an act of faith.
Despite their disagreements about history and what is a valid approach to the gospel material, some of these scholars seem to come to some very similar conclusions about Jesus. Take the parable of the prodigal son from Luke's gospel.
Once there was a man and he had two sons. And the younger son said to his father,
"Look, father, give me my part of the property."
So the father divided the family property between his two sons.
Not only have the gospel accounts of Jesus' life inspired great and varied art throughout the ages, in the latter part of this century, they've been adapted for the MTV generation.
And a few days later, oh, the youngest son packed up all he owned and he left for a foreign country where he wasted all his money in wild living.
This music video was developed by the American Bible Society as a way to speak to a new generation about the messages of the Gospels. This is the story of the prodigal son, the son who asks for his father's wealth, leaves the family fold, spends it all, and then asks to be taken back. Though scholars may disagree vehemently on what is meant by history and what is fact, this parable seems to span a crucial gap between those dueling in the so-called Jesus Wars.
And the parable isn't just about the welcome back, it's about the astonishing love of the father who, in the first place, lets the younger son have the cash down ahead of his death, which is unheard of in that culture. And in the second place, when the prodigal finally comes back, he runs down the road to meet him. Fathers in that culture, senior members of society in that culture, don't run. It's undignified. But this one throws his dignity into the trash can and runs down the road.
Father, I have sinned against God and against you. I no longer deserve to be called your son. No longer deserve to be called your son.
I see the younger son as a perfect image for the life in exile, the life in the far country away from God. I see the father as a perfect image of the graciousness of God who is overjoyed at our return. And the voice of the older son is basically the voice of conventional wisdom, which says, no, no, that's not how it is, that's not how it should be.
But the older brother was furious, and he refused to go in. So his father came out and began to beg him to come in. But he shot back to his father. Look, for years I have worked for you like a slave, and I have never disobeyed even one of your commands. But you have never given me even a little goat for a party with my friends. But when this son of yours shows up, who has wasted your property with prostitutes, for him, you butcher the fatted calf. Hey, la, oh, but the father said to him, my son, you are always at my side, and everything I have, it is yours. We must be glad and celebrate. For you see, your brother was dead, and now he's alive. He was lost, but now he's found. Oh, hallelujah. He was lost. He was lost, but now he's found. Now he's found.
For me, the prodigal son just showed the categorical love of the father for his children and the fact that one had gone astray but came back into the fold was just a powerful evidence of God's concern for every last individual.
I'm not even sure Jesus said it. In other words, as a critical biblical scholar, there is some difficulty in asserting flatly Jesus said this, because it's found only in Luke's gospel. It's not attested in the other gospels. But if Luke constructed this parable on the basis of his understanding of Jesus' teaching, he surely got it right. Because in this parable, it seems to me, we have an expression, powerful expression, of this call of God to humans who are erring, who go astray, who even turn aside from God. And yet God patiently waits for their response and welcomes their response. That parable speaks powerfully to me of Jesus' message about God.
When Jesus at 2000 returns, a look at the resurrection. Is it uncommon history or spiritual imagination?
Wherefore, O Lord and Heavenly Father, with this bread and this cup, we make the memorial of his saving passion, his resurrection from the dead, and his glorious ascension into heaven, and we look for the coming of his kingdom. We pray thee to accept this, our duty and service, and grant that we may so eat and drink these holy things in the presence of thy divine majesty, that we may be filled with thy grace and heavenly blessing.
Though many Jesus scholars may agree that part of his message points to a compassionate and forgiving God, when it comes to the concept of the resurrection, there is sharp disagreement. For most Christian believers, their faith points to existence beyond death, and it does so through the concept of Jesus' resurrection. For them, the resurrection turns graveyards, where life is obliterated, into cemeteries, where the dead await the moment of their own resurrection, in a manner similar to that of Jesus. But the understandings of that event and the term resurrection differ widely.
Now, supposing your experience was that this Jesus, whom you had known in Galilee and been able to touch and feel and was marvelous to be with because he gave you this tremendous empowerment from God, that Jesus was gone, but somehow you still experienced that empowerment. He was dead. They'd got him. They executed him. Maybe you didn't know he was dead for about 3 months afterwards. Maybe you were still trying to live the way he had taught you in Galilee, and then you found out, hey, they got him in Jerusalem. And it took a while to figure out, yeah, it's true. But somehow, as it were, the juice had not been turned off at 3 o'clock on a Friday afternoon. The kingdom hadn't disappeared. Of course it hadn't disappeared, because it was a kingdom of empowerment. It didn't depend on Jesus. Jesus had announced its presence. He didn't say, I'm it, and if I'm not here, it's over. He said, go do it yourself.
I think in some sense, the effect of the resurrection is the thing that is most palpable in reading the New Testament. It's the birth stories and the other stories that look the most dubious. That's not to say that it happened, but it's to say, or it's not to say that we can know what happened, but it seems to me that we can know definitely that the people who wrote the New Testament felt it had happened and felt it very strongly, and it affected everything that they did, said, and wrote.
The earliest, I think, development or understanding or exploration of the resurrection, and I'm working now in the second century, is that Jesus' resurrection means victory over death, that death is not in the end decisive. And there's another piece that's very significant in second century understanding of the victory over death, and that is that Jesus' victory over death was also a victory over all of the cosmic powers, all of the intermediary powers, which meant that the victory over death was a triumph also over all the forces that imprison, subdue, subject human communities and human societies.
I believe in the immortality of the soul. That is to say, the death of the human body is not the death of the person. And I have experienced that. Never in my life had I experienced it before our oldest daughter at the age of 50, on the full moon night of September, 18 months ago, died. She died at 7 p.m. There was an all-night vigil by her bed of members of the family. The presence of our daughter's soul, if you want to call it that, or I'll just call it her presence in that room, was more, and it's strange for our language, was more palpable, more real than the bed that her body was lying on. I mean, it was startling. You just sort of catch yourself looking around. Where is she? She was there. Now, she was a wonderful person, but she wasn't Jesus. When we put all that together, I do not have any problem of someone as God-filled as Christ, being palpable, not only that they sense that he was present, but they actually visually saw him and in certain cases could touch him.
Some scholars question the historicity of the events of the New Testament and completely reinterpret the traditional understanding of those events. While other scholars may not believe in the historical nature of the events of the New Testament, they believe those events carry deep spiritual significance. But here in Litchfield, England, the Reverend Tom Wright, who is Dean of Litchfield Cathedral, believes the events of the New Testament are historical and need to be understood precisely from that standpoint. You're saying that Jesus would not really have been recognized as the Messiah by his followers if he had not experienced, if the resurrection had not occurred, that he'd be considered a failure.
Yes, if he had been known or thought of as Messiah before his death, the fact of his death by crucifixion at the hands of the occupying forces meant, without a shadow of doubt, this man is not the Messiah. We backed the wrong horse. We know of several other messianic movements starting off in the first century BC around the time of Herod the Great, going right through the time of Jesus, right through to Simeon ben Cozibar in 135. Routinely, the Messiahs got picked up by the authorities, executed, and every Jew knew, well, whatever else you say about him, he may have been a prophet, but he wasn't the Messiah because they executed him.
In 1 Corinthians 15, Paul, and I think nobody has done it better, holds on to two things which are absolutely co-equal for him, that we're talking about the same Jesus in a totally different mode of being. It's the same Jesus, it's not another Jesus, not the memory of Jesus, the spirit of Jesus, the words of Jesus. It's the same Jesus, totally different. That is what resurrection is about. That the historical Jesus is now available anywhere where somebody believes in the historical Jesus. That is the risen Jesus.
What about this assertion? Did dogs or did scavengers eat his bones?
That's the worst case scenario. The best case scenario is he might have been buried in a lime-filled pit. That's what happened to people who were crucified. That's what you expect, and that's what I think actually happened.
And Marcus, you've said that Jesus rose, but he didn't have to do it in his body.
Right. As I see it, the resurrection is true independently of whether or not there was an empty tomb or anything happened to the corpse of Jesus. The truth of the resurrection is that Jesus continued to be experienced as a living reality after his death, both by his first followers and in the centuries ever since. So my objection to a physical bodily resurrection with an empty tomb as the proof of it is the role that that has played in saying that Christianity is the only true religion or that God acted in this tradition as God never has in any other tradition. It's that I object to as much as the question of possibility or impossibility.
Some of the basic concepts of Christianity are being reinterpreted by people working in the Jesus Seminar context. What's the problem with that?
For 2,000 years now, people have been living and dying, dying by the sword on the name of Jesus and on the very fact that he rose from the dead. And I continue to live my life in that same way or attempt to do that. And to change it to say, well, he didn't necessarily need to have risen bodily, undermines the whole reason for, the whole basis for why I live the way that I live my life. Now, if that's true, that he didn't rise from the body, I want to know that, and I want to wrestle with that and reinterpret my life. But the fact that it's not pleasing to someone, it's harder to believe, that's not the reason that I'll change the way that I live.
For me, as I look at the Bible, it is very important to me that it's historically accurate, because then that confirms for me that I can trust this document. And as you begin to say that the things that are recorded as historical narrative are not, then for me it casts doubt on the entire document.
The New Testament teaching on the resurrection is not a teaching about resuscitation. Resuscitation is only good news for the person who's resuscitated and maybe his family. It is not world changing. Nor is the resurrection for me simply an empty tomb. The empty tomb bespeaks an absence, but the resurrection is about a presence. Nor is the resurrection for me simply fugitive visions of a few followers for a short time after Jesus' death. It is rather a continuing presence to this day of a personal, powerful, transcendent presence in the world, which Christians call the power of the Holy Spirit, but they also call the Spirit of Jesus. The resurrection for me then is not about Jesus' past, but about Jesus' present.
Some of the scholars involved in the quest for the historical Jesus have been accused of trying to reinvent Christianity in their own image, and doing so as a reaction to their experience with forms of Christianity they found lacking. But many of these Jesus scholars also talk about their experience with this figure in ways that indicate their research and reflection has penetrated their souls as much as their minds.
I've been preoccupied with Jesus all of my life. My own devotional life is really more centered on God, with Jesus as a pointer to God, with Jesus as the face of God, if you will, or Jesus as the clearest embodiment of the sacred in human history. So for me, God remains devotionally more important, but with Jesus as the primary window through which we perceive the nature of God.
The relationship is permanent for me. It's not something that is done for a few hours on Sunday morning or even X number of minutes of prayer every day. It's the permanent thing I'm thinking about all the time. If I go jogging, that's what I'm thinking about. If I wake up in the middle of the night, can't get back to sleep, that's probably what I was thinking about. It's almost the fabric of my mind.
The purpose, I think, of the Gospels is to get you to understand that you are offered a choice and you should be a follower of this person from Galilee. And I think that that is the intention of the writers to different degrees. They all have other intentions as well. Mark has a different kind of community than Matthew or Luke or John, and they have their specific notions in mind. But I think what all four of them have in common is the notion not just to tell a biography, but to tell the good news that the world is no longer as it was, and you need to know it.
I think that the Jesus that the most ordinary person encounters in the pages of the Gospel is the real Jesus. He is the Jesus who did good, who healed, who spoke about God, who called people to repentance, who gave his life in obedience to God and in service to his brothers and sisters, who died on the cross and was raised from the dead. This is not complicated. The difficulty is not discovering who Jesus is, but acting as Jesus called us to act.
For me, that reality of who Jesus actually is something that sustains me and encourages me and rebukes me and challenges me every day of my life. And my historical investigation into Jesus runs along with that in parallel, that the more I find about who Jesus really was as a real figure in history, the more I am discovering who this person is that I have been dimly and fitfully trying to get to know for the last 40 years. And so the two are not in tension with each other, the historical and the faith. They work together. And all I can say is that for me, being a rigorous historian of the first century and being a practicing Christian actually meet and merge and knock sparks off each other the whole time.